A soft landing's in sight, but there are still some risks to consider. This is The Markets. Hi, I'm Sam Grobart. Today, I'm joined by Alexandra Wilson-Elizondo, co-chief investment officer of multi-asset solutions within Goldman Sachs Asset Management. Alexandra, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me again, Sam.
So you've recently written an article called Last Mile Investing, and in it you say that while a soft landing is in sight, there are still some complicating factors that could knock things off course. Inflation is still a little stickier than people would prefer. What are some of those key factors you're watching, and what could be their effects?
Our view has been for some time that growth should be around trend and prices are declining, albeit sporadically. But there are things that could lead to a fatter left or right tail in this very unusual cycle.
So when you're talking about left and right tail risks, left tail risk is to the negative, right tail is to the positive, yes?
Exactly, in the distribution of outcomes. And some of the things that we're watching as it relates to that are commodity prices, which have been benign, but an extension of recent strength like we've seen over the last couple of weeks could really dampen inflation progress. But if you move away from just the inflation and interest rate and Fed narrative,
I mean,
global
central banks. We've
been on that
narrative now for a while.
Exactly. There are some things that really merit an extra lens, a deeper dive. So some of those things for us that we're looking for potential ripple effects are China's ongoing macroeconomic challenges, what that could mean, geopolitics, especially in the run-up to the U.S. election.
Sure.
Right now, you could argue that the election footprint is actually small. You're starting to see it in some sectors, maybe some currencies. But we think that as the policies start to come to the forefront, that you could see much bigger impact taking place in the markets.
Given all of these factors, how should investors navigate this, what is effectively highly uncertain environment?
As investors, we strive to really build portfolios that are robust and navigate some wide range of outcomes. And we are constructive on the return prospects for both stocks and bonds, given the global cutting cycle should still come to fruition this year. But at the same time, we remain focused on incorporating portfolio themes that may benefit from growth reacceleration, cyclical upturns, as well as some structural tailwinds. So think about the four Ds: digitization, decarbonization, deglobalization, and demographics. So in that way, you can hopefully turn some tail risks into tailwinds into the portfolios. So considering the abundance of uncertainties that you've described, we think investors should also continue to evaluate whether the expected returns are sufficient to compensate for some of those risks. So you may be adjusting your portfolio a little bit more tactically than you otherwise would in this environment, just given prices are moving quickly, information is changing very rapidly.
You talked about equities and bonds, but where else can investors look to diversify?
There are two ways we're thinking about this. One is, while many economies have been moving in sync in terms of central bank policy and growth, there are some that are moving to their own rhythm. So when you think of Japan, which we can talk about at length, and I'm sure we will, you can play into some cyclical upturns in those geographies.
Gotcha.
The other segment that we have in the portfolio that we think is really important as a broader diversifier are alternatives. And as we've talked about in the past, they have some vol dampening properties, but they also can have acyclical properties. So if you think about private equity, you can have the dynamic of control and operational levers where you're turning the outcomes don't really depend on what's happening in the market around you.
Self-engineered, if you will.
Exactly.
More self-directed.
Exactly.
Okay. 2023 was obviously the year of AI, and that continues into 2024 with a small number of stocks powering indices to all-time highs. How do you see that force in markets evolving across this year and into the future? What are some of the second or third order effects from AI?
So my response will be somewhat interesting because AI is still relatively new.
Absolutely.
But I'm going to refer to it as the ecosystem is maturing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so people are getting more information about the real life outcomes across certain companies. There's distinctions happening in the market as it relates to rising tides aren't going to lift all boats for someone who attaches themselves to AI. And we do think that the opportunity set, not only will it be a distinction amongst the existing, you know, Magnificent Seven, if you will, but it's going to broaden out into other sectors that play a part into the ecosystems of delivering AI to the broader economy.
Does that get you into like mid and small caps as well as these mega cap tech companies?
Yeah, it does. Because a lot of them are suppliers, or even in some cases, they're delivering not just the software, but the individuals or some of the intellectual capital.
To implement this, to operationalize it, to actually make it real and effective.
Exactly.
Right.
But away from AI, and I think this is really important, the head of the equity team mentioned the other day, there are sectors that are materially outperforming the index that are not tech.
Right.
So if you think about energy right now, I think it's close to plus 15% positive on the year.
Yeah.
So there are themes emerging elsewhere, and there's some depth and breadth to the market at this point, which is encouraging.
More than just AI itself.
Exactly.
You mentioned Japan earlier. I wanted to ask you your sort of regional and global perspective right now. What areas outside of the U.S. are getting your attention?
So I'll start with Japan.
Please. Yeah, obviously. They're undergoing a pretty exciting time right now.
It really is.
Yeah.
And we have a very positive outlook on the Japanese economy because we believe that they're exiting a deflationary era. And you're starting to see things like very tight labor market, higher wage pressure, so real inflationary forces come to the forefront. And that in combination with a lot of the corporate governance reform that we've
seen. I was going to ask you about that. That's been happening over the past several years, right?
It has been, but now you're really starting to see tangible outcomes.
Okay.
So not only did you have the peer pressure version for corporates on, we need to get more women on the board, we should have
greater transparency.
A better control over the capital structure and what we're doing with share buybacks, et cetera. Now you're seeing some regulation, which we've seen come into the insurance sector recently. And that's caused some single name stocks to have some strong outperformance that we haven't seen in some time. And we still think that momentum will persist. The only thing to be thoughtful around is that the topics is very heavily focused on cyclical sectors like autos and semis. And so should there be any pressure from global recession trends, then that could put a little bit of a derailment there.
Right. Any other areas besides Japan that you're looking at?
Yeah, we're looking at Europe. So we have a very close eye on Europe. Valuations are a bit more reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
Macro momentum turned positive, I'd say, let's call it February. And that's been evidenced in PMIs, better than expected headline inflation prints. And we think that it's a good way to play the breadth expansion across the globe. So it was an underperformer versus the U.S. If you want to get into more sectors than just one,
mm-hmm.
it's a nice way to start opening up your portfolio to more outcomes in the broader global soft landing scenario.
Alexandra, always a pleasure. Thanks so much.
Thanks so much, Sam.
That does it for another episode of The Markets. Be sure to find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. To learn more, visit us at gs.com and subscribe to Briefings, our weekly newsletter on the global economy. I'm Sam Grobart. Thanks so much for listening. The opinions and views expressed in this program may not necessarily reflect the institutional views of Goldman Sachs or its affiliates. This program should not be copied, distributed, published, or reproduced in whole or in part, or disclosed by any recipient to any other person without the express written consent of Goldman Sachs. Each name of a third-party organization mentioned in this program is the property of the company to which it relates, is used here strictly for informational and identification purposes only, and is not used to imply any ownership or license rights between any such company and Goldman Sachs. The content of this program does not constitute a recommendation from any Goldman Sachs entity to the recipient and is provided for informational purposes only. Goldman Sachs is not providing any financial, economic, legal, investment, accounting, or tax advice through this program or to its recipient. Neither Goldman Sachs nor any of its affiliates makes any representation or warranty, express or implied, as to the accuracy or completeness of the statements or any information contained in this program and any liability, therefore, including in respect of direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage, is expressly disclaimed. Our theme music was composed by Soundboard.